Good morning, Bethel Chapel and Hopewell AME Church and our virtual family and friends. Welcome to our online services. We are so glad you chose to worship with us. May today's worship encourage, inspire, and uplift you. Let's get ready to worship.
Well, praise the Lord. Good morning, Bethel Chapel, Hopewell family, and all of our friends who have joined us for this time of wonderful praise and fellowship. It is good to dwell together in unity. It is good to worship God and to praise Him in spirit and in truth. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Our call to worship this morning says, come, let us worship God who provides for us. Even though we whine and complain, God still hears our cries. Somebody say, thank you, Lord. Lift up your voices in praise, for God has come to comfort us. Thanks be to God who forgives us, who heals our wounded souls, and let us celebrate God's steadfast love. Open our hearts, O Lord, and let us listen to your words. Open our mouths, O Lord, that we might declare your praise. Let us worship the Lord this morning. Father, we thank you for blessing us. We thank you for keeping us. God, we ask your anointing and your strength and your power to indwell us, Lord, even at this moment. Touch us wherever we are, whatever our needs might be. Use this time of worship to lift us up, to fill us with your spirit, to encourage us, God, to continue to run this race with patience, looking to Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith. Let the sick say that I'm well. Let the downtrodden say I'm uplifted. Lord, let the burden say, I have liberty in Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. We worship you and we praise you. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. For God, you alone are worthy of our praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Sing it.
Bow down and worship Him in church. Oh, in church. Oh, in
God. Lift your voice and worship Him now.
Some help in the house. All right. Anybody remember these kind of songs? See, I got a few on this side that already picked it up. Play it again. Come on. Let me see what y'all got. Listen. I'm a soldier. Yeah.
What an awesome time of worship. What an awesome time of praise. And it's good to share together this morning from the Word of God as God continues to speak to our hearts. Last week, we talked about battle-tested believers. This week, we're going to talk about the same topic. This is part two, battle-tested believers. I know that we all have been going through battles. I know that we all have been facing dilemmas and crises and problems. And sometimes we're frustrated because it just seems like, when is it going to end? It just seems like one thing keeps happening after the other. And I just want to encourage you, my brothers and sisters, that these battles come to make us strong, to make our faith strong in God, that we can understand that God, who is high and who is lifted up, is concerned about each and every one of you, no matter what you're dealing with, no matter what you're facing, even if you can't talk to nobody about it. You hadn't told your closest friend, your family doesn't even know or even understand, and you might feel like nobody cares. I want you to know that even in your spirit, even in your soul, to be able to stop and pause and say, God, I know that you are there. I know that you care about me. God wants to meet your need, and God hears your cry, and God will answer by and by. He wants you to know that he cares. This morning, part two of our message, Battle-Tested Believers, comes to us from Exodus chapter 14, beginning at the 10th through the 18th verses, and I'm reading from the New International Version. As Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after them. They were terrified and cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die? What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, 'Leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians'? It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert." Moses answered the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm, and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring to you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to move on. Raise your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea to divide the water so that the Israelites can go through the sea on dry ground. I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go in after them. And I will gain glory through Pharaoh and all his army, through his chariots and his horsemen. The Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I gain glory through Pharaoh and his chariots and his horsemen." Battle-Tested Believers, part two. You know, we think about all of the things that we have dealt with, all of the battles we have had to fight, all of the differences that we have experienced in life, and it makes us wonder. It makes us wonder, God, I know that you can do great things. God, I know that you are concerned about me. And last week in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, we found that King Jehoshaphat and the people of Judah were facing an enemy that was coming their way. And we know that they heard the voice of God through the prophet telling them that this battle is not yours, it's the Lord's. You will go down and face the enemy, but you won't have to fight the enemy. Set yourselves and stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. That phrase, set yourself, stand still, comes up frequently in the scripture. And it's a part of our text this morning. But you know what happens, that Hebrew word yasab, stand still, means take your position, stand firm, do not waver in this matter. In other words, you've got to make a decision that you're going to follow God no matter what might come your way. You've got to stand firm. You've got to have a conviction. You've got to have a made up mind that I am going to follow the Lord. And I know in this situation, the Lord has already made me a promise. This battle is not yours. It belongs to the Lord. We understand what happens in the scripture because the prophet gives King Jehoshaphat the word that God has spoken. And immediately they begin to praise God and and the praise was uttered. And I pray that you've been praising God and thanking God for what he has done in your life. And in the midst of their praise, the enemy got confused. The people of Judah, Judah means praise. The people of Judah were praising God, and their enemies in the middle of the night, they got confused and began to fight and defeat themselves. And there, that next morning, the people of Judah were able to go and pick up the spoils, able to march home with victory, and had all of the things that their enemies who were defeated, they had those in their hands, and they went home marching with victory. They didn't have to lift a sword. All they had to lift was praise and thanksgiving to God, and God fought their battles for them. And so I want to give you some confidence and assurance this morning. Who is a better fighter? You or God? I know you can probably firmly say that in your life, you fought some battles that you've lost. And then there were some battles that you fought that you wonder, why in the world did I fight that battle? And why did I go through what I went through, the way I went through it? But I come to give you some assurance this morning from the word of God. Romans 8:31 says, what shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? There's no devil or demon that can come against us. Amen. Because Christ, amen, has already purchased our victory. Amen. We are victorious this morning. Amen. God is for us. And when God is for us, who can be against us? 1 John 4:4 says, you, dear children, are from God. Greater is he who is within you than he who is in the world. Yes, it's the Lord's battle to fight, not yours. But the key is sometimes we are facing situations and we constantly want to give God a deadline, a time limit. I need you to come through. I need you to do this for me right now. And if you don't act on my timetable, then I begin to think, God, you are too late. It's over. There's no way that it's going to work out. But I come to tell you, God's ways are not your ways. God's thoughts are not your thoughts. God's time is not your time. God always acts, not according to our schedule, amen, but according to God's plan, because God is sovereign. He does what he wants to, when he wants to, the way he wants to, and through whomever God wants to. But God is searching and looking for people in the earth who would trust him in every crisis, in every trial, through every hopeless situation. Amen. God leads us into times that are alarming, times that are critical, times that are difficult, in order to test our faith to see if we're willing to stand on his promises. If what we have been praying about and what we have been worshiping, amen, to in our services, amen, if it's really real, amen, if we really believe the word of God, or do we just have a form of godliness? Do we really have a relationship with God, where we believe and know that God will make a way? Amen. God is our help. God is our strength. God is our refuge. Amen. There is nothing that God, amen, cannot handle. Nothing is too hard for God. Do we really believe that, or are we just going through the motions? The way you find out is when you are put into a situation where your faith in God is tested. That's where battles come in. And we are battle-tested believers, amen, because God is wanting us to know that we can trust him for supernatural deliverance. But the only way you can have supernatural deliverance is when you are in situations where you need a supernatural deliverer. I wish I had some witnesses this morning. Amen. I'm talking about situations where getting a Tylenol and taking a nap don't help you recover. I'm talking about situations that are too big for you, things that are too hard for you to deal with. When you don't know what to do, you can always trust in God, who is faithful, who is able. Amen. Because here's what we are reminded from Psalms 37:23. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. The word, a Hebrew word for ordered, means they are prearranged step by step. They are fixed and ordained by God. And many times in the Old Testament and throughout the Bible, we find God's people being led and put into certain situations that they find themselves in, that it seems like, how in the world are they going to get out of those situations? Well, the same God, amen, who was there in the beginning, was the same God who was there during the test, during the trial, and the same God who brought them out of it. Amen. One of those examples is the crisis at the Red Sea. Yes, the children of Israel had been praying and crying out to God. They were in slavery and bondage down in Egypt. And God heard their cries and sent Moses down to tell Pharaoh to let my people go. Pharaoh's heart was hard, and the plagues were sent all to let Pharaoh know that no matter how big and how large and in charge you think you are, I'm God. I'm going to have the last word. And even Moses, amen, picked it up in the affirmative when Moses said, now, who should I tell Pharaoh who sent me? And God said, tell him I am that I am. Oh, somebody needs to hear from the great I am this morning, because maybe you've got some unemployment issues that you are dealing with, and you're wondering who is going to get you through your unemployment when your check runs out. God is saying, I am. Amen. Somebody's wondering, if I get a bad report and that test result doesn't come back the way it should from my doctor, who's going to heal me? Who's going to calm my fears? God is saying, I am. Somebody's been wondering, this election that's going on, I don't know what's going to happen. Amen. I don't know what's going to happen in the United States of America. God is saying, amen, if you trust me, amen, and you're one nation under God, indivisible, God is saying, I am, amen, your source. I am, amen, your deliverer. I am the one who is in charge. Amen. There is nothing that is too hard for me. You got to believe in who God is. Here's the children of Israel. And finally, after the death angel comes through the land and strikes the firstborn in every household, but the children of Israel were spared because of the blood of the doorposts, Pharaoh finally lets the children of Israel go, and they have been led out. And the scripture says they have been led out, and they're on their way out of Egypt. And the Bible declares that the God hardened Pharaoh's heart so that he began to chase after the children of Israel. Isn't it amazing when you think you're away and you're free that the enemy still wants to come after you? He still wants to chase you. But I come to tell you that your steps are ordered by the Lord, and God is with you. God is leading you. God is taking care of you. But the Egyptians are pursuing the Israelites, and God specifically told them to camp between Migdol and Philereth. And this location was situated between two mountain passes, and the Red Sea was in front of them. So I want you to get this picture. Here are the children of Israel being led out of Egypt. They're on their way, the way God is leading them, as a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And God intentionally leads them in between two mountains, on the left side and on the right side. The Red Sea is in front of them, and Pharaoh's army is behind them, approaching them. It don't take a whole lot of folks to realize they are trapped, but they were not led into this position by the enemy. God put them in this position because God was going to do something greater through that situation. Whew. I wonder, somebody this morning who thinks that you are trapped, you're in a tight spot, and how in the world, and I'm going to get through this. Well, I come to tell you, the mountain might be on the left side, and the mountain might be on the red, on the right side. Amen. The Red Sea might be in front of you, and the enemy might be behind you, but look up, because God is still up above you, and God is in control of your situation. Look up, for your redemption draws now. Look up. Lift up your eyes to the hills from whence cometh your help. For all your help comes from the Lord. Instead of looking to the left side and seeing a problem, instead of looking to the right side seeing a problem, why don't you look up to the Lord and see your deliverance? God was doing something miraculous right before the eyes of the children of Israel. The Bible declares they were terrified and began to cry out to the Lord. And they said to Moses, was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die? Why are you bringing us out here to go out like this? Why didn't you just leave us alone? We told you to leave us alone back in Egypt, even though they were slaves. Now, because of the fear of the situation, because of the calamity that is around them and the crisis that they're dealing with, instead of being in faith, they begin to operate in fear. And I ask you the question, where is your faith in the midst of your crisis? When the things in your life, instead of getting better, are getting worse, when it seems like you are trapped and squeezed in and you're in this tight spot, and where is God in the midst of this? How do you react in the midst of crisis? Do you react based on what you see around you, or do you react based on what you know deep down in your soul? Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. I've got faith in who I know and what I believe, because I know God, even in the midst of what I am dealing with, God is greater than what I see. And if God brought me to this, I know God is going to bring me through this. The sixth verse in Hebrews 11 says, without faith, it's impossible to please God, because he that cometh to God must believe that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. The children of Israel are complaining. And I want to let you know this first point, I can't go back in fear and move forward in faith. They were already thinking about going back, thinking about what happened back then. They were thinking about the past instead of what God was going to do in their present, and what God was leading them to in their future. Amen. I know that I hadn't been all that I should be, but one thing I do know, I'm not going back. I'm not going back into slavery. I'm not going back into bondage. God has been too good to us, my brothers and sisters, for us to go back. Amen. Stop thinking about back then and ask God what's next. Amen. That's where faith comes in. I can't go back in fear and move forward in faith. You know, the biggest battle we'll face comes from within. When the enemy wants to try to make us believe that God doesn't care, he wants to make us believe that we're not going to get through, that he wants to make us believe that this is the end of the story. When God, who is the author and finisher of our faith, amen, God is still writing, and we shouldn't let the enemy put a period where God has put a comma. Amen. Because God comes in and steps in. Amen. But God, amen, will deliver. Amen. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers us out of them all. Second point, I can't move forward in faith until I learn to be still. Look at what Moses said in verse 13. Moses answered the people, do not be afraid. Stand firm, and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. The Lord was saying, the first matter you must deal with is your fear. I will fight for you. I will save you. I will deliver you. And this enemy that is behind you, that is coming and pursuing you, this enemy you see today, you'll never see again. I'm going to wipe out the enemy. Hallelujah. Because that is where your strength comes from. Amen. That is where your confidence comes from. When I can hear the voice of God, let it drive out all of my fear, because I heard the voice of God who promised me that he was going to deliver me. He was going to take care of me. He was going to provide for me. I've got to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. I've got to stand still, amen, and hear God's voice. Isaiah 30:21 says, thine ears shall hear a word behind thee saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. Ye shall turn to the right hand, and then you should turn to the left. It reminds me of a story of a farmer who went to the city, and he was talking to his banker, and they were walking along a sidewalk, leaving the bank and going to go get some lunch. And the farmer says, shh, shh, can't you hear the cricket? The businessman said, no, I don't hear no cricket. It's cars around here. People are talking. I can hear the cricket. The farmer said, yeah, that's a cricket around here. Be quiet, there's a cricket around here close by. Sure enough, they were walking, and close by a tree, there was this cricket that was down on the ground that the farmer picked up in the palm of his hand. And he said, see, I've been close to nature. I've been out on the farm, and I know what crickets sound like. The businessman said, how in the world, in all this noise, could you hear that cricket chirping in the midst of all this noise? And the farmer said, because I was listening. My ears attuned to that. I was listening. So the farmer went in his pocket. He took out some change, and he threw the change on the sidewalk. Ching-ling-ling all over there. All of a sudden, the people stopped. They began to look around. And the farmer said, I want you to know, you can hear what you want to hear. I heard the cricket because I'm used to nature. But people heard the change rattling because they were attuned to money. And the moral of the story is, we hear what we want to hear. Oh, won't we hear the voice of God this morning? Won't we hear his voice that is speaking to us, that's saying to us, amen, if I'm for you, I'm more than the whole world against you. The psalmist declared in Psalm 46 and 10, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. Literal translation of being still is Rapha. Cease and forsake all your striving and acknowledge that I am God. Stop all your efforts to deliver yourself. Stop making all your plans to try to do it your way. Acknowledge that I am God and I alone can save you. When you got faith in God, it changes everything. When you're standing still, it's an act of faith, an act of resting on God's promises. It is the determination that there is no question, there's no doubt in my mind, I know God will deliver. I stand still in faith, stand still in who I know and what I know. God is able. And because God is able, I know it's going to work out. 1 John 5 and 3 says, this is the love of God, to keep his commandments, and they are not burdensome. For everyone born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. My final point, and I'm finished. I get deliverance being still in God's presence and moving on by faith to experience God's power. Look at what it says in verse 15. The Lord said to Moses, why are you crying out to me? Why are the people crying out? Moses, tell the people to be still. But then he says, tell them to move on. It's time to move on. Moses, stretch out your staff. Divide the waters of the Red Sea on both sides so that the people can walk through on dry ground. This was the test of obedience for Moses and the children of Israel. They knew the mountains were on both sides. They knew the enemy was behind them. But the Red Sea in front of them, God said, that battle, I'm going to take care of it. I will divide. I will move it out of the way. Amen. When God's voice is leading you and guiding you and directing you and providing for you and preparing the way for you, you have victory. There's deliverance. Hallelujah. When you are being still in knowing who God is, you are still and know that he is God. When you are still in his presence, then you can move on by faith to experience God's power. You know what God was doing? Amen. Verse 18 says, the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I gain glory through Pharaoh, his chariots, and his horsemen. God was saying, amen, my power, amen, is greater than your enemy. They will know that I am God. When they see the waters, amen, stand up on both sides and the children of Israel walking through on dry ground, amen, they'll know that I am God. And you know what happened? All a million of those children of Israel, when you talk about the men and the children, amen, crossed through of the Red Sea on dry ground. Amen. God did it for them. God did it. He made a way for them. Hallelujah. And you know what happened when they got through on the other side? All the enemy thought that what God done for his people, he was going to do for the enemy. Oh no. Here comes Pharaoh and his chariots. Here come the Egyptians thinking they're going to make it through the Red Sea on dry ground. And when they got in the midst of the Red Sea, amen, God allowed the waters to come back, amen, and flow back into the Red Sea and drowned the enemy, amen, right in the visual view of the children of Israel. Won't God make a way for you? Won't God deliver you? Have you in a mountain that seems, amen, to be uncrossable? Have you in a river that seems to be uncrossable? Have you in a mountain you cannot tunnel through? God specializes in things that seem impossible, and he will do what no other power can do. Do I have a witness this morning? I'm moving on by faith this morning because I'm a battle-tested believer who knows that God is able. And I've seen him work. I've seen him do miracles. I've seen him work deliverance. Amen. I've seen God move in ways that only God can move. And God gets all the glory. Amen. He gets all the glory. He gets all the praise this morning. That's why I tell you, amen, be still and know that he is God. But when you're still in faith in your assurance of who God is, move on to what God has called you to do. Move on to your victory. Move on to your deliverance. I feel my help here this morning. Move on in spite of confusion. Move on in spite of racism. Move on in spite of hatred. Move on and vote, but be still and know that he is God. Move on and go on and do ministry. Move on and keep serving. Move on and keep loving. Move on and keep encouraging. Move on by God's power, because we're crossing over to the other side. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Amen. And keep your faith strong and assured. Keep your eyes on Jesus, who's the author and finisher of your faith. I'm pressing on this morning. The upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward by, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I'm glad this morning. I'm glad this morning and thankful that as battle-tested believers, we know that we can be still and know that he is God. And we can move on and experience deliverance that only God can give. Won't you give him praise this morning? Won't you thank him for what he has done and what he will do? No matter what is around you, no matter what enemy is behind you, no matter what you're facing in front of you, God still is in charge. He's up above. He's looking down and he's concerned, and he'll make a way for you. God bless you. We love you. Father, we pray now that you will speak, Lord, through these words. God, we pray that you encourage hearts. God, we pray that you enrich spirits. And if somebody this morning that does not know you as Lord and Savior, God, we pray that we get in a real relationship and say yes to Jesus, who is our Lord and Savior. Yes, Lord, I surrender my life. I thank you for what you have done for me. We give you praise, God. We give you honor and glory, for we know that you will fight every battle for us when we are still and know that you are God. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for what you have done. Thank you for your deliverance. And we thank you for joining us this morning and sharing with us in this worship experience. And we're praying for you. We encourage you. Be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. We encourage you, my brothers and sisters, to go and vote. Don't forget, wear your mask when you're out and about. Make sure to wash your hands. Watch your distance as things are going on around us. Just know that through this battle, God has got the victory. Praise God, for whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is our prayer. In the name of Jesus, we love you. God bless you.
I'm closing chapters. I'm turning pages. Glory to glory. And from faith to faith, I'm moving on. I'm moving on, I'm moving on. I'm getting older, so I'll keep it straight. It hurts to let go, but it hurts more to stay. I'm moving on, I'm moving on. Hey, I'm moving on. Hey, hey, hey. your failures. Woo! And forgive yourself for moving on.
I'm moving on.
Hey,
I'm moving on.
Hey,
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 hey.